On the 1st of March, 1831, Lord John Russell rose to his feet in the House of Commons. Pale and subdued, perhaps in anticipation of the political battle that was about to take place, Russell spoke for 2 hours as he introduced the Whig government's reform bill to a crowded chamber. "We wish to place ourselves between the two hostile parties," he explained, "between those who thought reform was unnecessary and those who argued that only universal suffrage would satisfy the popular demand for change." This moderation was the mark of what would become known as the Great Reform Act, and the man who introduced it 3 times to the Commons. Alongside a fairly limited extension of the franchise, the government's bill included a significant redistribution of seats, culling the small, rotten boroughs which often came under the control of an aristocrat or other wealthy patron, and were prone to bribery and corruption. "I'm in my politics for reform, and nothing but reform," Russell had declared in 1822, despite having first been elected for a borough firmly in the pocket of his own aristocratic family. Under the Whig Reform Bill, growing industrial centres such as Manchester and Leeds received MPs for the first time. But so too did smaller towns such as Whitby, which was given a seat to represent the shipping interest. Additionally, there were many extra seats for the counties, which were seen as important in representing respectable propertied opinion. For Russell and his Whig colleagues, it was the representation of interests rather than population which was key, balancing the different aspects of the Constitution and restoring public confidence in it and Parliament. As he stated later in 1831, this reform would not advance democracy, but it would make the Constitution harmonise with the present state of the people, making Britain's aristocratic leaders responsible to a wider public. The Reform Act finally received royal assent in June 1832, a success that owed much to Russell's influence. The same moderate stance and the desire to chart a middle course resurfaced in the 1850s and 1860s. While Russell was able to successfully navigate the Whig Reform Bill through Parliament in the early 1830s, his attempts to do the same in 1852, 1854, 1860 and 1866 all failed. Nevertheless, Russell deserves credit for successfully increasing the Irish electorate in 1850 and helping keep the issue of parliamentary reform on the agenda for front-bench politicians, not just for radical backbenchers. We should also remember that Russell's bill in 1866, though defeated, did play a part in prompting the Conservatives to pass the 1867 Reform Act, which ironically ended up being a far more radical measure than anything Russell had proposed.